okay? You know, most of the flood was in South St. Louis.
Right.
And so I'm talking about, I come in office in April of 93. May, they start putting up the floodgates. June, they're coming in saying, hey, well, I think, Mayor, we probably gonna have a pretty big flood here. So, I mean, mayors don't know much about floods.
Right.
You know, so I'm relying on them what to do. And
who are them?
Emergency management. Mm-hmm. We got fire department, of course, emergency management, and then the director of operations. Because some people, we still got some institutional memory, because some people remembered flood, the mm-hmm. last flood, mm-hmm. and what the procedure was. Well, a good thing about it was I said, well, let's assemble a major committee that's going to start meeting on a regular basis to start figuring out what to do and making preparation, emergency readiness. So we got McLeod Gas, Union Electric, you got to have the utilities involved. We had the fire department, the police department, and emergency management, and they met over at the Soldiers Memorial. So I'm one day, here we are, my birthday, July the 20th. So here we are, middle July, and they're saying, hey, River de Pere is about a foot from overrunning. And I said, well, what does that mean? Well, if the water comes over the levee at River de Pere, 8 feet of water will be in everybody's house within less than an hour in that area. People going to drown, folks going to get electrocuted, people going to get messed up. So I go over there. I said, well, let's go over there. And it was almost like a scene in a movie when I went. You had right over on River de Pere on streets like Courtois and some of the others. You had some folks who live right across the street from the levee.
Right.
Sitting out in lawn chairs drinking beer as if nothing really was getting ready to happen.
Wow.
And I said, look, I think this flood's going to come over that levee. Oh, no, Mayor, I was here in 72, and this is how far it came. They're trying to point, show. They were had turned into experts about the flood. So I said, okay. I will go back to my office about 2 days before
my
birthday.
Were you considering, could you order an evacuation?
Let me get to that point.
Yeah.
2 days before my birthday, they come in and say, you're going to have to declare a disaster. I said, what do you mean? He said, they told me, you got to turn these people's electricity off. You got to cut off their gas. You're going to have to evacuate them. You got to put them out their homes.
Wow.
I said, are you sure? And they said, yeah. I said, well, how many of them is it? They said, well, probably about 2,500 of them. And I said, well, how do we declare a disaster? They said, well, you probably just need to go over there to the site. I guess somebody told them I was coming, because when I got over there and was reading the document to declare the disaster, all the media was there. There were white people walking around with signs saying, the only disaster here is Bosley. And so I had to issue the orders. We cut off their electricity, we cut off their gas, we start pulling them out of their home. You're talking about some people that were upset. I mean, they were fit to be tied. Here's a black man who they hardly ever see black people over there, period. Now they're gonna come over and tell them, hey, we turn off your gas, we turn off your electricity. Within 48 hours, that water came over that levee. And the rest is history. You know, they were on television crying, talking about, well, we didn't know it was gonna be that bad, da 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 da. Well, I was on television, and they asked me, well, do I feel vindicated? I said, no, I don't feel vindicated. I'm just glad I did the right thing. And so that was 82. I talked to you about winning the clerk's race.
Right.
10 years later, 93, still not much has changed. Then I'm trying to be the mayor from 93 to 97.
You ended up going down there and doing some of the sandbagging.
Yes, I did. Yeah, we'd go down at night.
Yeah.
You know, I do all my meetings in the daytime. And then at night, we go down and, you know, Director of Parks and Recreation and Forestry, Gary Best, he'd have a crew of people down there every night. I mean, they would be sandbagging from 8 o'clock at night till 2 o'clock in the morning and going from various places trying to help people, you know. The other thing about that is, while the people had been put out and the water had come over the levee, you could smell, because, you know, it's sewage.
Yeah.
At night, you could smell the sewage, you could smell the urine, you could smell it. all the way over in North St. Louis. I come out of my house at Grand and Natural Bridge, and I could smell it from way over there, from my house all the way over to River de Pere.
Wow.
All right. So what happened also was the clergy, ministers, and black people started cooking food and taking blankets and clothing and stuff over there. People said, we don't want that. Take it back. They didn't want to accept food from the black churches. They didn't want to accept clothing from black people. They just didn't want anything from black people. And that's 93. So to me, that gives you a little microcosm of what we're dealing with here in our community. And the frustrating thing about it is not just white people, it's also black people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, some folks like it that way, some folks prefer that it be that way for whatever reason, if they're scared or whatever. But it's very deep and it's very thick, and it's hard for leaders to penetrate it, and it makes it so difficult that some people choose not to. And that's the most frustrating thing about it, because instead of stepping up, they step back. And what's that phrase, in order for evil to prevail, all it takes is for good people to do nothing.
Absolutely.
And the problem that we have here in this community is far many more good people around here than it is folks who don't want to do anything, but the good people, for fear of alienating others, choose to just not say it.
Well, you must think a lot about that. And I mean, do you have thoughts about how as a community, I mean, how do we move beyond that?
Well, my dad, I always talk about my father,
because
I learned a lot. My dad and my grandfather are always telling things, and I guess I was like a sponge soaking up a lot of stuff. Sometimes, you know, first time I hear it, I'd laugh and dismiss it, but as I got to be an older man, I draw on stuff. Like my dad used to say, son, some people you got to help in spite of themselves.
Yeah.
And so that has been my philosophy about things. And I guess one of the things that I feel good about for the most part is I try not to let things bother me to that extent. You know, you just do. You just try to do the best you can, try to help, try to push the ball further down the field. If folks want to help, then let them help. Those that don't, then that's fine too. But I have grown to accept that I can't expect people to see things the way I see it, or to accept things the way I accept them and work at it the way I do. I've learned that I have to pretty much go to where they are,
mm-hmm.
in their mind and in their level, and try to gradually bring them along.
Do you ever think to yourself, how am I ever going to get these votes from these people? It's like, I mean, it must have been frustrating, you know?
Oh, it was very frustrating. And, you know, one of the things is that about politics, one of the things a guy told me, he said, you got to love your job so much that you're willing to lose it. You know, and that's how it goes.